Hello, everybody. It's Servette Hassan. It's Sunday night. The name of the show is Intuitive Inc. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for tuning in. There's no Oscars, Super Bowl, anything else going on, Grammys Sunday. We're clear and free, and that's great because we have a really wonderful guest today. He's the author of a book called Discover Your Purpose, How to Use the Five Life Purpose Profiles to Unlock Your Hidden Potential and Live the Life You Were Meant to Live. And it really does help you discover your purpose. His name is Rhys Thomas, and I was a little skeptical about how he was going to put these into five life purpose profiles, but he actually did, and it made a lot of sense after I read the book. So we're going to discuss all of that. He's obviously an author, but also a speaker and a trainer in the energy medicine field is really where his expertise comes from. And that the book is a result of that. So, and he's also the creator of the Rhys Method transformational system that's taught at his Rhys Thomas Institute near Boston. Thank you, Rhys, for joining me today. Thank you.
So that's great to be here.
Thanks. It's a Sunday night. It's your time. I really appreciate when people call, you know, do this for me. So, and also you are obviously on the East Coast, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
Which
so
makes
it's
9 o'clock
here.
Yeah. Makes it even later. It's not quite so bad when people are on this coast, but so I really appreciate it double. So.
That's okay. I'm on a teacher schedule. We run certain weekends, and this wasn't one of my weekends, so I'm pretty flexible.
Oh, good. I appreciate it. Thank you. Okay, so let's dig right, because we only have an hour, and you think, oh, that's lots of time, and it's not, because this is a big subject, discover your purpose. It's the one thing that most of my clients come to me. It's the question I get asked most often is, like, I just don't know what my purpose is. And it comes from people who have little education, lots of education, a little bit of money, a lot of money. It comes from all the gamut. It runs the gamut. Is that true with you as well? Is that what you've been hearing and what led you to do this?
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. Yes. What led me to do this is basically the same thing that leads everybody to a midlife crisis, where you realize that the person you were so sure you were going to become, you aren't even at all. It's not really even part of your makeup at all. And at some point, we have to kind of come to grips with the fact that we have this quality within us that's been sort of reaching and pushing to get out of us. And we've been pushing it back in, trying to be successful at being the person that we thought we were supposed to be, the person that society wanted us to be, the person that mm-hmm. Was good and doing the right thing and making good money. But mm-hmm. you know, the issue is really that we have a spiritual purpose that's much deeper than the purpose that you know, that maybe our family or our culture sort of suggested for us. And that right. doesn't stays quiet for a while, but at some point we just have to step up and say, oh, what was that thing that I knew maybe as a child, but then I kind of put aside?
Right. That I call that our outside self. And then at some point, if it's not reconciling with our inside soul self, it will result in something like a nervous breakdown or a midlife crisis, whatever you want to call it, you know? And you had yours relatively young. I mean, you were a tennis pro. You were doing well. I think I read you were making $150,000 a year. You were, you know, living the dream and pretty young.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I actually had enough drive and enough focus and enough talent that I was teaching and teaching nationally and running businesses but in the tennis industry. So it's like I never had to wear a suit. I always got to wear my tennis clothes every day. Got to wear a warm suit to work. It was great. It was going very well, except that it was still being driven by my desire to be a successful businessman, which is what I was brought up to believe, that men should be. Even though my dad had been a teacher and a tennis pro, often children vowed never to be like their parents, and so I was like, well, I'll never be a teacher and a tennis pro. That'd be just crazy, because that was, you know, how can you make, you know, millions of dollars that way? And yet I've turned out to be a teacher and a tennis pro. but what I did was I became a very successful tennis pro and teacher. And I always kind of felt like, yeah, I really have a knack for teaching, but that's not really where I want to go. I want to go, and I started a company. I developed a product, a sports product that taught people how to be more coordinated. I ran big summer programs. I did a lot of things that were sort of, you know, business oriented, but I didn't really have a knack for that. And I didn't. It wasn't really my thing. And when I worked, I was working at a country club for 18 years, and I found that I didn't have what I was trying to be in the profiling system. I was trying to be what we call the knowledgeable achiever, which is really what all, if you do any business coaching or any type of business school or really any type of high graduate school, you have to be a knowledgeable achiever to succeed in the world. You have to have this ability to focus, see the big picture, do the work, get it done in a certain amount of time, be on, work your checklist. And I was absolutely sure that I could be that person because I have some of that quality within me. My mom was like that, and I was like, well, I can be that. But when I would go and submit my budgets to these Fortune 500 board members that I would hand it to, and they're looking at real budgets, used to looking at real budgets, I would hand it to them and they'd say, what is this? And I'd say, well, it's a budget. And they'd say, what do you mean it's a budget? And I said, well, this is the potential of the. They said, I don't want to know the potential. I want to know what you're doing. I want to know how. And so I always had this sort of side of me that was more creative than organized. And then it wasn't really until I really felt very misunderstood, even though I was successful and people liked me at my teaching, what I did and how I ran things. I couldn't get along with the people that were actually the successful people, and there was all sorts of conflict there. And I also found that I wasn't connecting well with my family, with trying to be this person that I really wasn't. I wasn't able to be the father that I really was born to be. I wasn't able to be the husband. Nothing really was working in my life, and that was when I found energy medicine and said, well, you know, and my body was starting to fail a little bit. I had some chronic problems, and I said, well, the doctors can't seem to do anything. I'll try energy medicine. I found a Barbara Brennan graduate, one of her top teachers, happened to be in the Boston area, and I started going to her, and I started discovering that there was something else inside of me that wasn't anything like I had shared in the world. And it was actually the part of me that I always felt, well, nobody wants to hear that stuff, like my dreams and my ideas about seeing the soul quality in people and all of these things that I always sort of like were like, yeah, that I can't, that everybody must be able to do that, and nobody wants to hear about that. They want to hear how to be more successful, and I thought, wow. When I went to energy school, I found out that was actually my real gift, and that was what I needed to be teaching in the world. And that really sort of woke me up to the realization that, wow, if I'm like this, and I was a pretty good study of people, and I studied my life. I had done the Tony Robbins and Wayne Dyer and Deepak Chopra and all these, you know, I really studied all of this stuff, and I thought, well, I knew who I was. And then I started doing energy work, and I realized I had no idea who I was. Right. And that sort of led to the realization that I started working with more and more people, and I'd already worked with thousands of people. I've worked with many thousands more. And so few people actually are able to capture the whole essence of who they really are, because there's so much thinking that goes on. There's so much who I'm supposed to be going on in our minds.
Right, exactly. Well, is this what led you to the Healing Arts and Sciences Institute? Or is that what happened to you? I think it's off the top of my head here. So
yes, yeah, yes. I started going. I'd had chronic sinus infections, and which are things that happen when you are constantly banging your head against other people's heads, and having a, you know, sort of, you know, mental battles, energetically, force that, create that. And when I found out that there's sort of reasons behind the types of illnesses that you get, and there's reasons that I am unable to, or I don't, what I call now, I say, I didn't have chakras for certain things. I have chakras for a lot of amazing things, but not for being a really well-organized businessman. And so that idea that I could be successful in my life that way was always a false promise. It became like an addiction, and I became a workaholic trying to be that person. And mm-hmm. addictions are very simply, if you can't fulfill your basic need of being who you really are, you mm-hmm. will try to fill that with somebody else, because I vowed to not be ever be sort of this high thinky artsy kind of person. I was going to be a tough guy, strong. I was also doing martial arts at the time and trying to be, you know, a right. fighter, and I just wasn't. But when you try to fill something, a primary need inside of you, with something that's not supposed to be, not that won't actually fill it, what happens is that you start panicking and you start realizing, oh my God, this isn't going to work, so I better do more of it. And so my being a workaholic was the pattern within my life where I was trying to be this thing, and it was the only thing I could think of being. And there was nothing else that really could help me. There was nothing out there. You know, I took the Myers-Briggs test, and it just proved what I already knew about myself, because right. it's just a behavioral test. Mm-hmm. And it told me that I was who I'm supposed to be, and there's a better way to be that person who I thought I was
exactly.
supposed to be.
Right.
But the truth is that energetically, our soul has a signature. And so as I was going through this work, I found the work of Alexander Lowe and Wilhelm Reich, and they had sort of started looking at these qualities within people that are very energetic rather than behavioral. And that was when I realized, oh, maybe we shouldn't be teaching people how to behave better, but how to feel better, how to feel and really heal at a deeper level, and then the behavior naturally shifts.
Right, exactly. Now, you know, you've said, because I agree, I think an addiction is when your body overtakes your spirit and your mind. And it, so you were able to get around that with energy medicine. So for people out there that have no idea what that is, can you mm-hmm. tell them? Because a lot of people think that's a lot of woohoo or, you know, waving your hands around. And I know it's more than that. So why don't you tell them what your definition is?
Oh, it's just waving your hands around.
Okay.
No, I'm okay.
I know. I love it. I know it's not.
No. Actually, I teach because I went to a 4-year training in energy medicine rather than a weekend workshop. Mm-hmm. There are a number of great techniques out there, acupuncture, for instance, Ayurvedic medicine, which you train for over a number of years as well. And they train you in different areas of the energy field, but what's happened is that energy medicine has to me it has a much deeper purpose than just technique. Even though right now the word energy medicine has been used to describe techniques of healing, which are relieving either chronic or acute pain. So you'll either go for a Reiki treatment or acupuncture or like I said, Ayurvedic medicine or craniosacral or a chiropractic adjustment or what, you're getting some kind of a technique used on you that relieves a block in the energy field. And so since it's not designed just to heal a muscle, it's designed to bring the body into energetic balance. It's called an energy medicine. And that is true. That is one element of energy medicine. To me, it's the least part of it. The biggest part of energy medicine is when a healer develops the ability to know their real purpose in life, and they exhibit that, and they express that from the inside out. So rather than being an outside-in person where they've figured out their life and they've learned a great technique and they know exactly how to do it and they get to work on time and they do the right thing and they know how to assess their clients and they do their thing and they have this great technique, what an energy medicine practitioner does is they are drawn to their life. They the clients come to them not because, if you think about the people that you go to, and if your listeners are thinking about, they go to a doctor, they go to a certain healer or even a therapist or they had a guidance counselor, they had a teacher in school that they would go to. Not because the person was a great math teacher, not because the person was a great doctor, but because that person was somebody that inspired them, that made them feel good about themselves, because there was something in them that was in balance. My favorite energy medicine practitioner is Martin Luther King. And I don't think he put a lot of people on a healing table and waved his hands around, even though he probably could have. He was a big, strong, energetic guy. He probably could have done some great healing that way. But what he did was he matched his deeper life purpose with a modality, which was speaking and preaching.
Mm-hmm.
And through that modality, he became a world-changing healer.
Right.
And that's really what an energy medicine practitioner is. An energy medicine practitioner, like Malala, for instance, is someone who finds that who they are is an unstoppable force. And they just need to get out of their way until that force finds a method of expressing itself in the world. And that might be staying at home, taking care of the kids. It doesn't have to be, some big, you don't have to be Martin Luther King changing the world. You just change one world, one person's world, and that's enough maybe that person becomes the next Martin Luther King. So, but knowing your purpose and then matching a modality to it, especially if we're talking about energy medicine specifically, the most important part of becoming an energy medicine practitioner is figuring out what modality you were born to express, rather than saying, hey, this is a good one, everybody's doing it, people like it and they'll pay money for it, I'm going to learn that technique. The chances of that being your technique are maybe 1 in 20 or maybe 1 in 100. If you learn who you are, though, and then recognize that there's a healing technique you've been already expressing and sharing your whole life, and it's how people run great businesses, it's how people find their soulmate, it's how people find and transform their health in a huge way, is finding this inner sense of self and then using modalities or using the elements of your life to express that.
Right. I know, because people often get stuck because they know who they are, but then they think they have the way to do it, and it's only that way. Like, I need to be an actor. I need to be a this, so I'm going to do it. Rather than getting out of their own way and letting it just happen by itself, without the struggle.
Right.
Get stuck.
And what you're called to,
exactly.
I call the midlife crisis the midlife calling, because it's the time when the soul voice becomes loud enough that you can actually hear it.
Right, right. Now, so how then did you come up with the five profiles?
Well, the five profiles were originally Alexander Lohan and Wilhelm Reich came up with five. They actually had six. But one was sort of the same thing, so I just went with five. And they had five ways. They were psychiatrists in sanitariums, right? And so they were working with really crazy people. And they said there were five ways that people went crazy, and those were schizoid and the oral. They called it, these were their designations: the schizoid, the oral, the masochist, the rigid, and the psychopath. That's how people went crazy.
Uh-huh.
But they had some very deep, and Alexander Lohan later took this and created bioenergetics out of this. And it was a healing modality, really, to bring people from being very broken up to coping with life. And we learned it as this when I went to school for energy medicine, energy medicine training. One of the things that we learned was this system of assessing, being so you can assess your client as to what, because each of those different qualities had very different armoring and ways they betrayed themselves and sabotaged themselves in life and where they went, were having anxiety and fears. And so we learned about that. But as we were learning it, I started looking and saying, well, but the soul doesn't just leave you with broken stuff. It's like, it's, you know, that may be a result of not living your actual purpose. So what's the actual purpose in this? What's the actual quality of this? And Anna Day Judith did a little bit of work with this as well, using the system, and Barbara Brennan did as well. And so I sort of looked at what they had talked about, and they had definitely talked about these as these human qualities, but they hadn't really made that leap to say that these are actually the soul qualities, that there are five different species of soul, of human being on the planet. And some are deep feelers. Some are really super creative and not really of this world. Some are very caretaking and big and strong and helpful. And others are achievers that you know, do very, very well in school and become the doctors and lawyers and the highly educated people in the world. And then there are leaders who are incredibly dynamic people that can really do any of the others, the creative, the deep feeling, the caretaking, or the achieving. They can do any of those, but they add this level of inspiration to those things. And those qualities within people I saw as being, because I was also coaching at the time, I was coaching national professional tennis players, and I was always looking for a greatness within them that was not something that was just standard, you know, because I noticed that every person had a reason that they played that was very different than everybody else. But some people tended to be able to be more, you know, more disciplined. Others could really win in the clutch. Others were much better team doubles players. Others could never pay attention, you know, and others were just, right. It was just too overwhelming for them. And I was always like, wow, there seemed, so I'd already seen these qualities in people for many, many years in my teaching, but this system sort of, gave me an opportunity to see that yes, we all break down and go into what we call defense in very specific ways, but that defense is usually hiding the greatness within us. And so those deep feelers are lovers. Those super creative people are geniuses. Those team playing people are the best friends you've ever had. Those achievers are the people that make life graceful and organized for all of us. And the leaders are the ones who inspire us in many, many different ways.
Right. Okay, so you found out you went from being a knowledgeable achiever to probably a charismatic leader charmer?
I went from a knowledgeable achiever to, and I realized that who I really am is a creative idealist.
Idealist, yeah.
So,
okay,
this creative sort of, you know, process in my head that said, well, this is crazy. People don't know about this. This should be common knowledge. If you don't know who you are,
right,
you're going to live in a trial and error life. Everything you do is going to be trial and error. And some people, of course, if you have 7.5 billion people, some people will guess right, but most won't. And so most people are out there living this life that they're just like, I don't know why it doesn't work for me. I'm trying. I'm doing all the right things that work for my brother. It's not working for me.
Right.
And so my creative idealist, you know, created, and I run an energy medicine school where we basically, it's like a mystery school, and everybody comes in and we just start working on their soul from the moment they walk in the door and create power within them and help them with their relationships and understanding themselves. So that creative idealist then uses my secondary qualities of being a little bit of a knowledgeable achiever, and certainly when I speak like this, I'm very, very enthusiastic and inspirational. And so I use my secondary qualities of charismatic leading and knowledgeable achieving to be successful, but it all serves, you have to find out what your chakras serve. And my chakras serve my creativity, and I never do the same thing twice. I always teach differently every weekend, because it's the creative process that I love to be part of.
Right. And guess what I am? I'm a creative. Go ahead.
I would bet that you have both the creative idealist and a little charismatic leader.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So that was my question too. Then I'm definitely a creative idealist. Then and then I do a radio show, I do workshops, I do all those things.
Right.
I've narrowed it down to those two. So then how do you blend them? I mean, your book is let's go back a second here. I have to tell people, when you go into these each category to figure out who you really are, there's a whole series of questions and ways to figure it out, but also how to deal with what you are, right?
Right, absolutely. And one of the things that, you know, that is different about the system is that it really understands that we all have this ability and sort of shadow side, our lower self side, that likes to be in resistance to things. And there's a way that we all do that. And so creative people tend to, if you find yourself with lots of anxiety, you know, that's the way the creative person has their fear. The super deep emotional loving people that are very, very soft, their defense, the way they go into fear is by being overwhelmed, and then we call them they have this poor me quality, where it's really they feel like a victim of the world. The world is too intense for them. And then the team player, the people that are just your best friends, they're always there for everybody and take care of everybody, their defense is what we call people pleasing, where they can't say no to anybody, and they get incredibly resentful, and they're always like, well, when is it going to be my turn? And they never get their turn because they will never ask for their turn. And so so people can often see themselves in the defense. And so we ask questions about both. And of course, the knowledgeable achiever, will often do what I did, which is they will become workaholics. They will push themselves beyond their limits because they're actually pretty good at that. And nobody's going to stop you from becoming incredibly successful or incredibly more successful, even if you end up having a heart attack, over it. People don't stop you until the heart attack.
Right.
And then finally, the charismatic leaders often are big sabotagers. They because they have so much energy, they'll build something up really fast and it'll be amazing, and then they get bored of it and then they sabotage it. And they say, I'm out of here. I'm going to go to the next thing. I'm going to that. I'm doing this. And they have they will tend to have more of a sabotaging type of an energy, and they can be very volatile because they have lots of emotion and lots of energy.
Right.
So in each of the chapters, you find out, one, this amazing quality that you can see in yourself. And, of course, we all have all five qualities, but one of them is the one that your soul carries through every lifetime. And it's when you do that quality, when you have that quality, and one of the exercises in the book is called Your Secret Place. And everybody, when they were children, somewhere, somehow found a place, whether it was with a grandparent, or on their own out in the woods, or down in the basement, or up in the attic, or someplace. It's some place that was their place where they, when they were little and when they were younger, they just were totally free to be who they were. Mm-hmm. And what you did in that place is actually your life purpose. It's actually what you should be doing as an adult. And so for me, which was really fun, I had two places. One, actually I had three but there were two main places, where one was up in a tree where I really felt like I was part of the sky, and I was flying, and I was totally free and out there, and loved to be up there way high, way, way, way high up, 80 feet up in a pine tree with one of those pine cone, Christmas tree type pine trees where the top is really thin and it sways back and forth in the breeze. I'd be up there right at the very top holding on to the stick. And then the other place that I had was a sort of a rocky knoll up behind the house, where I would go up there and I would use sticks and rocks and mud and leaves, and I would make superheroes. And so when I realized my life purpose, and I realized how much fun that was for me to do those things, I realized that now I go up into the top of that tree and expand my energy out in infinite ways to draw in these new ideas, and then I use those ideas to create superheroes. I have about 110 students that come to me every year in the program. Every year we meet for 5 weekends at the Institute, and And the major thing I want to do with them is show them this superhero quality that's within them that they also knew in their secret place. It was sort of like they knew that they had this quality of being really intelligent or being really soft or being really strong and like a pirate, or, you know, they had these qualities within them that they knew as children, and then they lost because there's no place for that in our culture, in our society. You have to become, you know, a man or a woman, and there's a whole bunch of rules. And at some point in their childhood, we had to make this impossible choice mm-hmm. between being who we actually are and being loved. And even though we can have the most loving, wonderful parents, mm-hmm. there were still rules around being a human being and being and growing up. And if you had stayed in your secret place all the time, you would have probably ended up with a therapist rather than in school. And children know that, and they know, and they just watch how their parents are, and they watch how their parents have shut down their superhero quality, and they also say, okay, at some point I've got to give that up. And when we give that up, we give up most of our energy that we have to live our purpose, and we just get enough to survive.
Yep, I know that feeling well. It was all, well, you need to be out there making money, you need to be out there, you know, right. supporting your daughter, doing this, doing that. You can't just go off and write. I've heard
that'd be
it
crazy.
Yeah, exactly. It's halfway through the show already, so I'm going to open the lines if it's okay with you. And
sure.
Also, the number is 949-313-8880. I'm on the line here with Rhys Thomas, who's the author of Discover Your Purpose. So if you don't know what your purpose is, call us now, 949-313-8880. And now, Rhys, while we have a second, the book is awesome, and I encourage everyone to get that. But what's your website, and what are you doing next?
Okay. The website for the book is discoveryourpurposebook.com. You can get it at Barnes and Nobles and at Amazon. But if you go to discoveryourpurposebook.com, you can buy the book. It will come from Amazon, but you'll also get a whole bunch of, like, a member site and some videos and some trainings. So some bonuses that you get if you go to our site and buy the book. And I actually have a business book coming within the next few months, but how to apply these qualities to your business. But what I have coming up in May is a live event called Awaken. It's both live streamed, so if you live somewhere far away from Boston, you can live stream in. But if you can come, it's a 2-day event, May 20th and 21st. And it is where we share, we do somewhere in the range of about 150 different awakening processes over a 3-year period at the Rhys Thomas Institute. And we offer as many as we can fit in 2 days on that weekend. And we use many, many different types of meditations and energy work and self-discovery work that you really can only get if you're in the school. So we kind of pull back the curtain a little bit each year and bring people in and share with them some of the techniques that we have had incredible success transforming people's lives and pulling out their superhero.
Well, that's awesome. And that, when is that event?
That's May 20th and 21st, and it's at the it's in Dedham, Massachusetts. And it's actually the event itself is only $50, and you get to bring a friend. So
wow.
If you go to awakenevent.com, okay. you can sign up for the event and bring a friend.
Wow, I want to come.
It's so much fun.
Oh God, I love that. That's awesome, and I love that you kept the price down. You know, $50
yeah.
for yourself and a friend is really, really, really nice. So great.
Yep.
Then your business book. What's is that? Discover Your Purpose in Business, or How to Use? What's the title?
Developing a there, now you've put me on the spot.
No, it's okay.
It's still in editing right now, but a purpose-centered business.
Okay,
developing a purpose-centered business.
Okay, so now you need to do one on love.
So you've absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Because you've got business.
And child raising, you know,
right,
because if you know your children, how much of an advantage will you have if you know why your children behave the way they behave? And you're not in such an argument with that anymore. So yes, and definitely about love as well.
And
reverence.
Our soul. It's good to understand that the part I liked about your book is that it is know yourself. It's know your soul. Know who you are, because that's all of my teaching revolves around that. And I remember when I had my daughter just graduated from the University of Pennsylvania Law School, this was a long road. UC Berkeley.
Congratulations, by
thank
the way.
You. And she passed the New York bar on the first try. So, so she's at a big firm. So you can imagine that, you know, and I was born in Pakistan in 1958 when they were still burying baby girls alive. So my name means treasure in English because they didn't bury me. And, so my daughter and I went at it one day, just went at it like, late high school, right before she left for college. And she said, "What did you expect you would raise? I'm just a strong, independent woman, and I'm always going to be one." And I was like, "Oh, my God." And then I said, so I looked at her, and I said, "You know what? It's true." And I also said to her, I said, "But don't forget, you picked me." And she was like, "What?" I said, "When you were up there, your soul, you picked me." And she started laughing, and she said, "I must have been in a hurry." I'll never forget that. That was like, I heard Wayne Dyer telling a similar story, and I was like, oh, my God, my daughter did the same thing to me. It was like really, yeah.
Well, and they all do. And one of the fun things about the profiles is when you get more advanced in developing your ability to assess profiles, you can't have profiles your parents didn't have.
Oh, that's interesting. Elaborate on that.
Well, you're getting your energetics from your parents. And so you're right. You children do pick. I mean, the soul picks the perfect parents to give them all the wounds they need to become strong enough to then fight for who they truly are. And so we never consider us as being the parents that the children have to go to therapy about, but we all are. But the children, you know, what happens is that the father and the mother both have two different qualities of the profiles, and that combination of those profiles, of those energies that were in the house or in the parents, that physical energy and emotional and spiritual energy that they had blends to create the child. That's why the children are always more advanced spiritually than the parents.
Right.
So children come in, even though the parents will always believe that they're more advanced, it's not. Each generation of children are the combination of the parents. So they have that double energy. And what ends up happening is that often the children find that they will want to be like one parent more than another, and will literally say, they'll make what I call a vow against being like a certain parent. If there was a mean parent, or there was an angry, or there was, you know, or a crazy parent, you know, the child says, "Well, I'll never be like that."
Right.
But what happens? The problem that happens at that point is that the child can't tell the difference between the energy and the behavior. And the child says, "I'll never do that behavior," but since they haven't distinguished between energy and behavior, they then shut off that ability to have the energy. And even though the parent may have used the energy in a very destructive or in a very bad way, the truth is that energy is never bad.
Right.
It's just how it's pushed out in the world.
Right.
And so the child ends up growing up whenever that energy comes up with them, and because they get half the energy from the mom and half from the dad, that energy comes up to be expressed because they need that to be who they are. And when they vowed not to have it, what happens is they go into internal battle with themselves, or they shut things down, and they end up stop being able to feel that energy, right. But it never goes away. And that's what drives, like we were saying, that's what drives addictions. When we are not willing to fulfill our real needs, which are to express all of who we are, because we vow not to have it and we shut those feelings down, those feelings don't stop calling to us, but we have no resource to fill them. And so that's why we look outside of ourselves to drugs or drinking or right. smoking or
food
eating,
or
those
anything.
Types of things to fill that empty space.
Right. I often tell people, well, you're just eating your feelings, you know, a
right.
lot, or whatever, drinking your feeling, whatever. But it's true,
right.
you know. I mean, I can see
yeah.
that in my life. I learned early on that I pushed away because my mother was 12 when she married my father, who was 16 or something, without seeing each other. But she was very subservient. So I vowed I would never be that way, ever. So,
right.
but then I just shut out men altogether, which, you know,
right.
of course, it took me a while to go through this whole process. Your book was not around.
Right, of course. That's why I wrote the book.
Yeah,
because there's
exactly.
so many people. I started doing energy work with tons and tons of people, and I'm realizing, wow, you know, if they just knew who they were, we could get from point A to point, you know,
right.
X, you know, in a very short period of time, rather than the slow slogging process that people go through with the deep process and this.
Right.
When you discover who you are and start living that,
right.
that's the forgiveness that everybody's been waiting for.
Right.
Forgiveness
I,
isn't
yeah.
a matter of saying, I need to forgive that person for being like this, or I need to view. It's not. When you are living your purpose, you have forgiven. There is no more need to forgive. Your past is ancient history to you. You are living. And that's and when you remember this greatness within you and can see where it belongs and how it works,
mm-hmm.
you'll see that every event that happened in your life, including having, you know, the vows about your mom, you
mm-hmm.
know, playing small and
mm-hmm.
maybe not being as tough as your dad or you know, whatever it is, these vows that we all make because of the traumas in our lives, and just the story alone that you were lucky you weren't buried, that had to be something that sort of drove you to say, hey, I'm not wasting any time here. So those types of things that happen in our lives, when you realize that you are a leader, of course you're going to come into the world in a war zone, in an area where it's like, you know, I've got to survive. And,
right.
and a leader is a person that learns how to rise to the top and survive.
Right. But, you know, I did. I had to learn all this the hard way. And it wasn't until I was like 50, late 40s, because I was busy raising a daughter as a single mother, and that I finally went, oh, to thine own self be true. And I started telling the truth, not just about myself, but in my writing, in my work, in everything I did, it changed everything. And that,
yeah.
You know, it was suddenly, I'm not going to try to be not who I am. I'm going to be me.
Right.
And once I did yeah. that, everything became so much easier. Unbelievable.
So much.
Yeah, isn't it?
Yeah.
And that's
well,
what your work is all about.
Except for the first time you do it, and everybody else you know says, what, are you crazy?
Well,
but yes, and because that's the opening, that was when you opened your heart. Because
right.
you had to shut down your heart to survive.
Right.
And that was why the relationship wasn't there, and that's why all of that. So that was the
right.
so there was a tough, you know, you had to literally shut down to be, you know, to be that next level up of your parents in resistance to them, rather than in the, you know, the fact is that, you know, your parents gave you incredible gifts. And
right.
and seeing those gifts rather than how they manage those gifts is really the key to knowing yourself as well.
Right, right. And to me, the forgiveness thing was really important, what you said. I think that the definition of wisdom for me and what I've been taught is that you can look at your past and take the lesson and no longer allow it to affect you as a person. And then you can look back at everything and say, oh, my God, I wouldn't change a hair on a person's head. Because it's all
true.
Okay. It's all okay.
True.
Yeah.
And what I teach is around, especially around the profiles, which is one of the basic elements of what we teach in school. We also really map the seven chakras and the five spiritual centers with their archetypes and their guides, and you know, which are the archetypal guides, and all of the elements that are within those, and And the, you know, and when you learn this quality of who you are and who you've always been, you should be able to look back at your life and see that every event that ever happened in your life wasn't, you may not have responded very well to it, but it was trying to wake up your greatness within you. And if you see your life that way, see, the problem is that anybody who looks back at their life and says, well, that shouldn't have happened, anything that goes on in your life that you say, that should not have happened. And I know that people have some horrific stories and terrible things that happen to them and terrible wounds. But the biggest wound is the belief that it shouldn't have happened, because what happens if you believe that there's something in your past that shouldn't have happened, you have to live in fear in the present moment. Because if something has happened in your past that shouldn't have happened, you have to live every moment on guard that something in the future will happen that wasn't supposed to happen either.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
And so this is one of the big spiritual sort of like wake up moments where people realize, oh, everything, you know, there are no victims except for dead people. The only victims are dead people. And the truth is that if I survive something, I'm now stronger from that. Mm-hmm. And now that I can see why that happened, because I know, if I know my big why I'm here, I'm here as a creative idealist, and I'm here to bring these ideas forward, I can see every event that happened in my life and all the trauma and all the elements that didn't work out and how I was betrayed and how I was left behind all of these elements happened, and I can see, oh, that was really calling forward this gift that I have, rather than punishing me in some way, if some karmic punishment, that's another way to look at spiritual things, you know, rather than saying, oh, it's always calling me to this power within me. And then when I look forward to my life, I'm not in some guarded position saying, well, I definitely don't want to have this happen again or that happen again. You know, when you're open to your life coming to you, it does come to you in both ways, both amazing and challenging. And when you're only looking for the amazing and you're afraid of the challenging, you will be holding back so much you don't get the amazing.
Wow, that was good. Well said. Well said. No, exactly. It's true. Okay, we have time for a quick question if anybody wants to call in and ask about their discovering their purpose. We don't have much time left, so do it now. If you be brave, come on. And then people say to me later, oh, I had a question. And then I'm like, okay. 949-313-8880. So, you know, yes, just do it. Just call.
So your listeners, think about which one of those you are. Which one do you think you are? Do you think you're a super creative person, artistic? Are you a deep, deep feeler? Do you really have a deep emotion? Are you a person that's caretaking everybody and always there for people? Are you very achieving oriented, and driven and organized? Or are you a leader? And sometimes, especially for women, it's very difficult to own the leader. Because they don't want to be thought of as bossy or pushy.
Oh.
And yet there's no difference in the world. You grew up in Pakistan where all women are expected to be either emotional intelligence specialists or team players, and all men are expected to be either knowledgeable achievers or charismatic leaders or warriors.
Right.
Nobody really wants to be the one who's not in their body and the thinker.
Right.
And yet there's an even energetically, there's an absolutely even number of all in the world. And actually there are, my personal study is showing that there's actually, I'd say about 40% or more of all of the people on the planet are charismatic leaders. And so that means we got a planet of chiefs and not enough Indians. And because we're a tough planet, this is not an easy planet to live on. It's a warring planet. It has never stopped warring. It has never stopped being a place where you either fit in as a warrior or you need to fight to to transform the world and stand up for the rights mm-hmm. of other people, be like a Martin Luther King. I mean, he was a
right.
true warrior that did it, that didn't do it in a typical get a bazooka and shoot people type of way. He did it through non-resistance, and that's really
right.
the type of warriors that every charismatic leader, every person out there who's going to war,
right.
that's their shadow. The light side of that person is a person who could fight for peace.
Right. That was the Gandhis, the Martin Luther Kings. Exactly. And it was interesting what you said. Yeah, what you said about the knowledgeable achievers. I actually grew up in London and Montreal, and I'm British and Canadian and an American citizen. But I, you know, it's funny because I have a daughter who's not afraid to be a leader, you know, in that.
Right.
Exactly. Yeah, it's interesting. And I agree with you. Nothing happens by mistake. I don't think there are any accidents in our life at all.
None.
So, oh, well, we didn't have any callers, and they'll all call me tomorrow and say they with their nine
That's okay.
questions.
You can send me an email and say, well, we have this question.
Okay, good. Tell people where your website again so that because they'll listen later and they'll want to.
Yeah. My website is www.rhysthomasinstitute.com. So it's Rhys, R-H-Y-S, Thomas, Institute.com. And you can go on there, and I've got all sorts of stuff. You can find out, you can look at about the school mm-hmm. that I run. It's 5 weekends a year, and you come in and totally transform your life. And we have some products in there and my book, and you can, and of course, the Awaken event coming up in May. So there's all sorts of stuff you can check out in there, and there's also a way to contact me through that, through the website. So if you want to,
right.
if you have a big question, that's the way to do it.
Right. And the Awaken event is awakenevent.com. And
yes.
you also have a website for the book called discoverthebook.com. So if you want to buy,
discover your purpose, which is the name of the book.
Okay.
Book.com.
Okay.
So discoveryourpurposebook.com is for that.
For that. But, yeah. but I encourage you to buy it off of there because you said you get bonus material with it. So that's
a lot
nice.
Of bonus material. Yeah. You can go to Amazon and pick up my book or Barnes & Noble's. But if you go to discoveryourpurposebook.com, that'll be the best because you'll get all sorts of goodies with that.
Right. It's hard to put, you have to get the book because really to understand the five profiles and how you work that to find out who you really are inside isn't something we can do in an hour. You know, I could talk to you for another hour and I'd still be like, okay, a little more time because it's a big subject. You know,
it is,
and
it is a big subject. And I do have there is a questionnaire in the book, and on my website there's also a free profile assessment that actually mm-hmm. sends you some videos. It's a great way to introduce yourself to them. Take the free assessment, and then there's a full assessment that really looks at all of the elements, you know, the deeper elements of your both the shadows or sort of the defensive qualities as well as the higher qualities. So it goes deeper into the understanding of it. But there's easy ways to get started. The free profile assessment is one great way. And so everybody can try that out and sort of say, well, what am I? Because you don't want to just, you know, the difference between what I do and what, say, the Myers-Briggs or Enneagram or DISC, and there's a number
right.
of others out there that are
right.
doing profiling, they, all of the other systems are behavioral based.
Right.
And so what ends up happening is that when you study yourself behaviorally, of course, our brain tells us to be certain things and do certain behaviors. And so if I and I did take these tests earlier on in my career, and I always came out as close to what we have is, which is the knowledgeable achiever, this organized, structured, you know, person, because that's how I saw myself, and that was all my behaviors led
right.
me to see myself that way.
Well,
but it wasn't until I went deeper and sort of felt, oh, what do I feel like? How does this, what triggers within me? What's my real mm-hmm. need inside that I was able to then recognize that the questions need to be asked about these deeper qualities that we have to kind of say, oh, yeah, that's really the motivation for those behaviors.
Yeah, exactly. I like what you did in the book, too, because you also did what the profiles are not, which explains kind of that, you know, what you just said. Because really, it's not just a behavioral thing. And, you know, I know I'm a creative idealist, but it's not because I'm published three books. It's because that's who I am on a deep level, you know, and I have something to say. And I could be 92 and on my deathbed, and I'd still have something to say.
Something to say, right.
Yeah.
And so you have, and I have those two qualities as well, and that's one of the reasons why getting on the radio or speaking and teaching and getting out in front of a lot of people, mm-hmm. writing books, those are all things we have this creative idea and mission, and then we also have a real drive to inspire people with it. And if you have a creative idealist without the charismatic leader, you're going to have it's going to be much harder to bring forward a product, or, you know, they wouldn't come on the radio. They just wouldn't have enough of a fifth chakra to do it. They wouldn't be able to speak. You know, they would be very quiet and sort of maybe they'd talk and they'd be off the wall.
Right.
They'd be over somewhere else. And so I do find that lots of radio show hosts, especially the ones that have me on and want to talk about more spiritual energies, are very balanced in the two of both the creative idealist and the charismatic leader. And that's why, you know, because you're bringing ideas forward, you're having guests on, and you're able to entertain their ideas and then make that inspiring to all of your fans.
Right. Exactly. It's true. Well, we're out of time. So this is it. It's Rhys Thomas. Thank you very much. And it's Rhys Thomas, RHYSTHOMAS.com. Everything's on there.
Institute.com.
Institute.com. Now we got it.
Yep.
Rhys Thomas. Institute.com. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart for doing this on a Sunday night so late. I appreciate it. And I know people are just going to love this book. Discover Your Purpose, Rhys Thomas. It's awesome. And I think it actually, if you have any doubts about what you should be doing, this will guide you in that direction. And you've done a great job. I love the book. Thank you.
Thank you, Savette.
Thank you for doing this. I appreciate it. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Well, that was a great show. I am thrilled to have him on. The book is great. Discover Your Purpose, Rhys Thomas, R-H-Y-S Thomas, T-H-O-M-A-S, and it's his name with the word institute after it, .com, because I screwed that up a second ago. And honestly, if you go through these profiles, you do discover a bit more of what you, to thine own self be true. When you know who you are, there's nothing you can't do. And I say that every time at the end of every show. I always say, be you to the full, because that's what's truly beautiful, even though it's not the end of the show. It will be in about a minute, and so I'll say it again then. But my website is servethasan.com, servethasan.com. All of my books are on there. I'm going to start blogging again. I keep saying that, but I promise it's coming up really soon. I've got a bunch of new ideas that are, you know, sort of incubating in my mind, as I say. So, and I don't push things, because I think if something's not coming out, it's okay, because then it's just going to come out wrong. But everything you need to know about me is on my website. Like I said, the three books I've published with Llewellyn Worldwide. All of my shows go up on the YouTube channel, Servette Hassan channel, after a couple of days later. So if you miss it or you want to hear it again, you can go on YouTube.com, Servette Hassan channel. And like I said, I'll start blogging again really soon. And I am available, you know, as you all know, for private sessions. I just did a workshop today, so I'm not going to be doing another one for a little while at Awakenings here in Laguna. But I am looking to travel. I'm not looking to travel. I'm actually going to be traveling. And so I will post on my website and send out blasts on where I am and what I'm doing. Mostly though, lately it's been private, workshops. So I don't put those on my website because they're not open to the public. So I'll be speaking at, you know, corporations and things like that, so that I can't really put that up there. Other than that, be you to the full. Because when you do try, when you do find who you truly are, everything does work so much easier. So, and tune in next week. I've got another great guest and it's going to be a lot of fun. And thank you for joining me tonight and take care. Bye.